Back to life, back to reality. Back to life, back to reality. Back to life, back to reality. Back to the here and now, yeah. Show me how, decide what you want from me. Tell me maybe I could be there for you.
Welcome, family, to another episode of God's Glory and History. I am your host, MC Enemy, but as always, it's not about me. It's about the Word of God and His truth on this channel. Welcome to Fellowship. This episode is scheduled to be aired Friday, August 2nd, 2024. Yah is looking for people to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And on this channel, we focus on His truth. And we let His truth set you free. Got a scripture for those who do not believe or don't think it's important to know what our Messiah looks like. Just the highlighted portion of Revelation chapter 4, verses 3. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and sardine stone. And there was a rainbow about the throne in sight, like unto an emerald. So you can see on the right, the jasper and the sardine stone. And any combination of those two would be considered someone who has the skin tone of a quote unquote black man. But I like to say a swarthy man or a melanated man. And in light of the fact that Mr. Milikowski recently gave a speech to our Congress, I just wanted to point out the fact that that is or was his surname. His father changed his surname when he came to Palestine and gave the name, the surname of Netanyahu. So his family is Ashkenazi. Predominantly, and Ashkenaz is a descendant of Japheth, not Shem. Take what you want from that. I'm just giving you the facts. You make your own decisions. And don't forget the prayer of Paul to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 through 21. If you read it, it will bless you with an understanding of God's word and his love for you. If you haven't done so yet or you're new to the channel, most important thing is that you download and study at least two Bible apps. And the reason why we say at least two Bible apps is right in the middle of your screen. The facts of every case must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. And we ask that you make one of those apps the 1611 King James Bible with the Apocrypha. There are additional books in there that you can get, cannot get in the standard 66 book version. And you wouldn't go to a bookstore, spend your hard-earned money to buy a book knowing that there's pages and chapters missing. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe. More importantly to me is that you share this with others. You may not know who you are putting on a path to the Messiah. All right, This episode is, once again, this is dedicated to our dearly departed sister, Sonya Massey. I mentioned her in the last week's episode, but I'm dedicating this one in her memory. It may give us some type of explanation, those who are searching for an explanation as to senselessness. Well, this episode is dedicated to that. And it's episode 202, Perpetual Hatred. Let's get to work. 1611 King James Bible, Ezekiel chapter 35, verses 3 through 5. It is written, "And say unto it, thus saith Yah, your God, behold, O Mount Seir, I am against thee, and I will stretch out mine hand against thee, and I will make thee most desolate." Just going to pause for a minute. For those who do not know, Mount Seir is a reference to Edom, which is a reference to the descendants of Esau. All right, going to continue on. "I will lay thy cities waste, and thou shalt be desolate, and thou shalt know that I am Yah, because thou hast had a perpetual hatred and hast shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword in the time of their calamity, in the time that their iniquity had an end." All right, so for those of you who say I'm using a school word on a weekday, here's the definition of perpetual: never ending or changing. Similar words would be everlasting or incessant, uninterrupted. So never-ending hatred is what they have for us. But why is that? We're going to dive into a little bit of that history. All right, so here is the Book of Jubilees. And if you go into chapter 36, there you have some of Isaac's last words. You know, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Isaac was dying, and he had some words for his sons, Jacob and Esau. And those who don't know, those two are twins. Esau came out first. Jacob came out second. All right, so Jubilees chapter 36, it is written, "I say and testify to you, my sons, according to judgment which will come upon the man who wisheth to injure his brother. And he divided all his possessions between the two on that day. And he gave the larger portion to him that was the firstborn, and the tower, and all that was about it, and all that Abraham possessed at the well of the oath. And he said, this larger portion I shall give to the firstborn. And Esau said, I have sold to Jacob and given my birthright to Jacob. To him let it be given. And I have not a single word to say regarding it, for it is his. And Isaac said, may a blessing rest upon you, my sons, and upon your seed this day, for you have given me rest, and my heart is not pained concerning the birthright, lest thou should work wickedness on account." So those who don't know the backstory, just to recap, Esau was the firstborn. They normally get the larger portion of any inheritance. But Jacob bought the birthright from Esau for a bowl of red stew, pottage stew. And then the blessing, when the blessing was come due, Jacob and his mother conspired to trick Isaac, because Isaac sent Esau off to get some game meat to cook him stew. And in his absence, Esau was dressed up to smell like Esau. Jacob was dressed to smell like Esau and had a hairy coat on him to feel like Esau because Isaac's sight was failing him. All right. And so that's how Jacob got the blessing on top of buying the birthright. All right, so Jubilees chapter 37. It is written, "And on the day that Isaac, the father of Jacob and Esau, died, the sons of Esau heard that Isaac had given the portion of the elder to his younger son Jacob, and they were very angry. And they strove with their father, saying, 'Why has thy father given Jacob the portion of the elder and passed over thee, although thou art the elder and Jacob the younger?' And he said unto them, 'Because I sold my birthright.'" Reading on. "So because I sold my birthright to Jacob for a small mess of lentils, and on the day my father sent me to hunt and catch and bring him something that he should eat and bless me, he came with guile and brought my father food and drink. And my father blessed him and put me under his hand. And now our father hath caused us to swear, me and him, that we shall not mutually devise evil, either against his brother, and that we shall continue in love and in peace, each with his brother, and not make our ways corrupt." In the latter form of the legend, this is altered. So this is not really part of the words. This is just something in the margin that they said. So going on to verse 5. "And they said unto him, 'We shall not,'" and when I say we, I'm talking about Esau's sons, "'we shall not hearken unto thee to make peace with him, for our strength is greater than his strength, and we are more powerful than he. We shall go against him and slay him and destroy him and his sons. And if thou wilt not go with us, we shall do hurt to thee also.'" I got to pause there for a minute. None of us would have the nerve to raise up against our father in that manner, even in his older age when he can't do anything about it. We just don't have that kind of disrespect for our fathers. Reading on. "And now hearken unto us, let us send to Aram," which I believe is what we call Syria now, "the suzerain power in their day, who sought to oppose the Jews or the Israelites or the Yahudim, and whose yoke was ultimately entirely thrown off. We go to Philistia and to Moab and to Ammon, and let us choose men who are ardent for battle, and let us go against him and do battle with him, and let us exterminate him from the earth before he groweth strong." "And their father said unto them, 'Do not go and do not make war with him, lest ye fall before him.' And they said unto him, 'This too is exactly thy mode of action from thy youth until this day. And thou art putting thy neck under his yoke. We shall not hearken to these words.' And they sent to Aram and to Adoram, to the friends of their father, and they hired along with them 1,000 fighting men, choosing men of war. And there came to them from Moab and from the children of Ammon, those who were hired, 1,000 chosen men, and from Philistia, 1,000 chosen men of war, and from Edom, and from the Horites, 1,000 chosen fighting men, and from Kittim, mighty men of war. And they said unto their father, 'Go forth with them and lead them, else we shall slay thee.' And he was filled with wrath," this is Esau, "and indignation on seeing that his sons were forcing him to go before them to lead them against Jacob, his brother. But afterward, he remembered all the evil which lay hidden in his heart against Jacob, his brother. And he remembered not the oath which he had sworn to his father and to his mother, that he would devise no evil all his days against Jacob, his brother. And notwithstanding all this, Jacob knew not that they were coming against him to battle. And he was mourning for Leah, his wife, until they approached very near to the tower with 4,000 warriors and chosen men of war. And the men of Hebron sent to him, saying, "Behold, thy brother hath come against thee to fight thee with 4,000 girt with sword, and they carry shields and weapons, for they loved Jacob more than Esau." So they told him, for Jacob was a more liberal and merciful man. Going on to chapter 38, and I don't have the verses here in chapter 38, but you can find it in Jubilees chapter 38. And after that, Judah spake to Jacob, his father, and said unto him, "Bend thy bow, father, and send forth thy arrow, and cast down the adversary, and slay the enemy. And mayest thou have the power, for we shall not slay thy brother, for he is such as thou, and he is like thee. Let us give him this honor." Then Jacob bent his bow, and sent forth the arrow, and struck Esau, his brother, on his right breast, and slew him. All right, so that's the story that we get from Jubilees. But I got another version of this story, and there's some differences, which means something is wrong, right? Because the Bible will not contradict itself. So I have a warning, new warning, on the book of Jasher. And that warning is that we cannot authenticate the book of Jasher. So while it has the name of Jasher, it may not be the authentic book of Jasher. Now, Jasher is mentioned in the Bible in a couple of places, two or three places. But just because a book bears that name does not mean that it is the authentic book. So the book of Jasher that we have now was not found among the Dead Sea Scrolls, which can be dated back to hundreds of years and thousands of years ago. And the writing that we do have from the book of Jasher was written in a more modern form of Hebrew. It wasn't written in the Paleo Hebrew or the pictograph type of Hebrew from back in those earlier days. But we're going to look at the book of Jasher anyway, because I still believe it's a valuable resource. Even though we can't authenticate it, I want you to take it with a grain of salt, because it still gives us some very likely things that took place during those times. All right, so let's look at the book of Jasher, chapter 56, starting at verse 46. And because I can't authenticate the book of Jasher no more, I'm going to try not to be saying it is written with that, because it doesn't have the same weight without the authentication. And the report reached Esau, saying, "Jacob died in Egypt, and his sons and all Egypt are conveying him to the land of Canaan to bury him." And Esau heard this thing and was dwelling in Mount Seir. And he rose up with his sons and all his people and all his household, a people exceedingly great. And they came to mourn and weep over Jacob. And it came to pass, when Esau came and mourned for his brother Jacob, and all Egypt and all Canaan rose up and mourned a great mourning with Esau over Jacob in that place. And Joseph, his brethren, brought their father Jacob from that place, and they went to Hebron to bury Jacob in the cave by his father. And they came unto Kiriath Arba to the cave. As they came, Esau stood with his sons against Joseph and his brethren as a hindrance in the cave, saying, Jacob shall not be buried therein, for it belongeth to us and to our father. And Joseph and his brethren heard the words of Esau's sons, and they were exceedingly wroth or pissed. And Joseph approached unto Esau, saying, what is this thing which they have spoken? Surely my father Jacob brought it from thee for great riches after the death of Isaac. Now 25 years ago, and also all the land of Canaan he brought from thee and from thy sons and thy seed after thee. And Jacob brought it for his sons and his seed after him for an inheritance forever. And why speakest thou these things this day? And Esau answered, saying, thou speakest falsely and utterest lies, for I sold not anything belonging to me in all this land, as thou sayest. Neither did my brother Jacob buy. Now I'm going to back up for a second because I want you guys to see something. If I can back up here without... it's not letting me back up. But obviously you can see that there are some discrepancies here, because now if, as in Jubilee said, if Jacob killed Esau, how are they now fighting over the cave for Isaac? To bury Isaac. So obviously something doesn't jive, and I have to give the heavier weight to Jubilees because it is authenticated by the Dead Sea Scrolls. But that doesn't mean that everything in here is wrong. It just means that you can't corroborate it and you have to take it with that grain of salt. All right, so we're going to continue on. Belonging to me in this land. And Esau spoke these things in order to deceive Joseph with his words. For Esau knew that Joseph was not present in those days when Esau sold all belonging to him in the land of Canaan to Jacob. And Joseph said to Esau, surely my father inserted these things with thee in the record of purchase and testified the record with witnesses. And behold, it is with us in Egypt. And Esau answered, saying unto him, bring the record. All that thou wilt find in the record, so we will do. And Joseph called unto Naphtali, his brother, and said, hasten quickly, stay not, and run, I pray thee, to Egypt, and bring all the records of the purchase, the seal record, and the open record, and also all the first records in which all the transactions of the birthright are written. Fetch thou, and thou shalt bring them unto us hither, that we may know from them all the words of Esau and his sons, which they spoke this day. And Naphtali hearkened to the voice of Joseph, and hastened and ran to go down to Egypt. And Naphtali was lighter on foot than any of the stags, I guess that's horses, that were upon the wilderness. For he would go upon ears of corn without crushing them. Now, that gives you a sort of a cartoon type of look, right? He's running so fast that he can run on top of the corn fields without crushing the corn stalks. I don't know if that's his literary license, the writer, or just something that is just so far out in left field we can't believe it, but it's there. So we're going to read on. And when Esau saw that Naphtali had gone to fetch the records, he and his sons increased their resistance against the cave. And Esau and all his people rose up against Joseph and his brethren to battle. And all the sons of Jacob and the people of Egypt fought with Esau and his men. And the sons of Esau and his people were smitten before the sons of Jacob. And the sons of Jacob slew Esau's people 40 men. And Cushim, the son of Dan, the son of Jacob, so Jacob's grandson, was at that time with Jacob's sons, but he was about 100 cubits distance from the place of battle, for he remained with the children of Jacob's sons by Jacob's bier, I guess that's his coffin of some sort, to guard it. And Cushim was dumb and deaf. Still, he understood the voice of consternation amongst men. And he asked, saying, "Why do you not bury the dead? And what is this great consternation?" And they answered him with the words of Esau and his sons. And he ran to Esau in the midst of the battle, and he slew Esau with a sword. And he cut off his head, and it sprang to a distance. And Esau fell amongst the people of the battle. And when Cushim did this thing, the sons of Jacob prevailed over the sons of Esau. And the sons of Jacob buried their father, Jacob, by force in the cave. And the sons of Esau beheld it. And Jacob was buried in Hebron, in the cave of Machpelah, which Abraham had bought from the sons of Heth for the possession of a burial place. And he was buried in a very costly garment. And no king had such honor paid him as Joseph paid unto his father at his death. For he buried him with great honor, like unto the burial of kings. And Joseph, his brethren, made a mourning of 7 days for their father. All right, so there's the opposing story from Jasher. Take from it what you will, but the sentiment of the anger and hatred still prevails, even though there's inconsistencies. So thousands of years later now, still at it. We're going to go into the Maccabees. This is in that intertestamental period. So it's in between the Old Testament and the New Testament. This is somewhere in the area of the 100 BC. All right. So it says here, the rule of Hyrcanus the first. So his name was actually John, but known later as Hyrcanus the first. He remained as high priest in Jerusalem until his death of 104 BCE. His was a long and disturbed reign, but he consolidated and extended Jewish control, bringing Samaria into subjection, and even forcing the Idumeans, the descendants of ancient Edomites, who lived south of the Dead Sea, to accept Judaism. That is how the Idumean King Herod of Jesus's day was a Jew by religion. So again, a convert, right? Even though it was a forced convert, they were converts. John Hyrcanus marked the reign turning point in the history of the Maccabees, the movement that had begun with intense conviction and deep patriotic zeal had so completely succeeded that all memory of its first wild enthusiasm had gone. John in spirit had become a Sadducee, an upper class conservative who accepted only the written law as divinely revealed and authoritative. In outlook, he was worldly, agnostic, and urbane, utterly unlike his grandfather. All right, so that's from Britannica. So now we're going to look at some of the words of the Book of Maccabees. First Maccabees chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. It is written, "Now when the nations round about heard that the altar was built and the sanctuary renewed as before, it displeased them very much. Wherefore they thought to destroy the generation of Jacob that was among them. And thereupon they began to slay and destroy the people. Then Judas fought against the children of Esau in Idumea at Arbatin, because they besieged Gael. And he gave them a great overthrow. and abated their courage and took their spoils. Also, he remembered the injury of the children of Bian, who had been a snare and an offense unto the people, and that they lay in wait for them in the ways. He shut them up, therefore, in the towers, and encamped against them, and destroyed them utterly, and burned the towers of that place with fire, and all that were therein. So skipping down now, still in Maccabees, in that first Maccabees chapter 5, and now we're skipping down to verses 60 through 68, it is written, "And so it was that Joseph and Arzuras were put to flight and pursued unto the borders of Judea. And there were slain in that day the people of Israel, about 2,000 men. Thus there was a great overthrow among the children of Israel, because they were not obedient unto Judas and his brethren, but thought to do some valiant act. Moreover, these men came not of the seed of those by whose hand deliverance was given unto Israel." So they were not Israelites. Says it. You guys can read that for yourself. I didn't write it. Reading on, "Howbeit the man Judas and his brethren were greatly renowned in the sight of all Israel and of all the heathen, wheresoever their name was heard of, insomuch as the people assembled unto them with joyful acclamation. Afterward went Judas forth with his brethren and fought against the children of Esau in the land towards the south, where he smote Hebron and the towns thereof, and pulled down the fortress of it, and burned the towers thereof round about. From thence he removed to go into the land of the Philistines, and passed through Samaria. At that time certain priests, desirous to show their valor, were slain in battle, for that they went out to fight unadvisedly. So Judas turned to Azotus in the land of the Philistines, and when he had pulled down their altars and burned their carved images with fire, and spoiled their cities, he returned into the land of Judea." All right, so again, fighting continues. Perpetual hatred. The scriptures say perpetual hatred. And so instead of us trying to change something that we have no control over, I believe our time is better served by seeking perpetual life. You've already been forgiven, brothers and sisters. All you need to do is ABC. Accept them, and there's only one way to get it. Accept the Messiah as your personal Savior. Believe he died for your sins and confess it with your mouth. The Messiah said it best in Matthew chapter 12, verse 34. And I'm paraphrasing, if you truly believe something in your heart, you'll have no problem saying it. So pause the video and recite this simple prayer. I'm not asking you, I'm telling you, because time is of the essence. Time is short. Tomorrow's not promised to you. So you need to get in where you fit in. And if you recited this prayer with sincerity and repentance in your heart, let me be the first to welcome you to the family. Now, if you accepted Christ today, please drop us a line in the comments that simply says, "I'm in." That way we can celebrate with the angels for your arrival. Now, on this channel, we don't make orphans. It's a simple three-step process for you to continue your walk. Step number one is to read your Bible daily. Episode 62 on this channel will guide you how to read the Bible. Step number two, find a Bible-based place to grow. This has to be one that is not stuck in the doctrines of men, meaning that everything they do needs to be backed up by the word of Yah. And then step number three is to pray without ceasing. Bring all your cares and concerns and lay them at the foot of the Most High Yah, and then rinse and repeat. All right, so the various channels you can check us out on. Again, like, comment, subscribe. But please share this with others. Help us out with that algorithm. Give us some thumbs up. And if you haven't subscribed, we'd love to have you as a member of the channel. All right. Thank you, family, for allowing me to grow in knowledge. And in turn, I pray that you grow in the faith. Thank you guys for watching. I hope this edified you. I love you guys, but Christ loves you best. As always, worship the Father, praise the Son, and accept the Holy Spirit. May our Lord and Savior grant you his peace that surpasses all understanding. May it rest, rule, and abide with you, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.